Welcome to Hot Copy. Now in its 12th year, the groundbreaking play Vagina Monologues is set to go on stage again this weekend. Theater actress Monique Wilson is at the helm of the local production. Here's a look at her advocacy and her colorful career.
Monique Wilson was born to the stage. She had appeared in over 60 professional productions by the time she was 17. In 1989, at the age of 18, she was chosen to play the lead role of Kim in the original London production of Miss Saigon. She took on acting and directing and even the movies. She also pursued her dream of completing her drama training in London, where she has been living for the past 10 years. She's doing all these as she runs the theater group New Voice Company. These days, Monique is involved in several Filipino productions, including The Vagina Monologues, a piece written by Tony Award-winning playwright Eve Ensler, which features a compendium of women's voices and memories aimed at empowering women and celebrating female sexuality. This time, it goes on stage for the benefit of Lila Pilipino, an organization for comfort women in the Philippines. Plans are also on to tour an original play entitled The Male Voice around the country and across Asia. Come September, Monique is also set to take the stage via the upcoming local production of The King and I. Today, for all her pursuits in the local and international stage, Monique is bent on being a formidable voice for women and on helping to keep theater alive in the country.
And joining us on Hot Copy, theater actress, director, New Voice Company founder, and activist. Ang dami naman nito. Monique Wilson, good day to you, Monique.
Hello.
Thank you
good
for
morning.
Coming.
Thanks for having me.
Wait, you are going to be Anna of The King and I?
Yes.
Okay, so you're taking a leave from London.
Yeah, I mean, from where I teach in London, because I run a master's degree there.
Okay, now tell us about you. How have you been after all these years? Of course, the last that many remember you would be Miss Saigon.
Yeah, I'm good. I mean, I've been running my theater company now here in Manila for 16 years, but I come back and forth because I moved to London actually after Miss Saigon. I came back here, but after a few years, I moved back to London in 2001, got my master's degree in theater because it was really my dream, and then I decided to stay there and teach. So I've been teaching drama there ever since, first at Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts and then now at East 15 Acting School. But since I also run my theater company, I come back and forth to produce shows and direct and train here.
Okay. Now, why didn't you just continue an on-stage career? I mean, you were already Kim in Miss Saigon. Mm-hmm. That's like a major part of a resume.
Well, you know, I think, Karen, I've been acting since I was 9. You know this, you know.
Oh, burnout.
We went to high school together.
Yeah.
And I feel like I've done so many roles and so many parts, and I think there's huge parts of me that want to explore other things. I've always loved to direct. And you know, Bibot Amador, who was my mentor in Repertory Philippines, she forced me to teach a drama workshop when I was 14. And then I taught 52 children that first summer, and I thought, hindi ko kaya to. This is too hard. But actually, I found that I loved it. I love teaching drama. And it became also part of my passion. So I think I've always taught, directed, and acted. So it was, I think, just natural to hone my other skills in terms of the teaching and the directing, because I'd been acting for so long.
Okay, so in London, you teach professionals or students?
Yes, I teach postgraduate students. So majority of them have been professional actors from their countries, because I teach an international course. So these are actors from all over the world who come to England to take their master's or MFA in theater.
Yeah.
And then they go back to their home countries and run theater groups. Or produce or write.
No, I was going to say, I'm sure people have told you have a striking resemblance to Lea Salonga.
Yeah, I guess that's why maybe they cast us in Miss Saigon.
I know.
No, but a lot of people have said that.
Yeah. No, I mean, you started Miss Saigon together, I guess. You trained together.
And we grew up in repertory together.
Yeah. Was there ever any sense of competition?
No, you know, a lot of people ask me this. It's, you know, because Lea and I grew up in repertory. And, you know, life in theater is hard. You know, people don't know this, we have to work really hard. We have to be very professional and devoted and committed. So to us who are trained in theater, it's really about the work. It's not showbiz, it's not about the stardom, it's not about the attention that you get, it's about working hard. So I think because Leigh and I grew up in that, you know, we sort of never bothered ourselves with all the gossip that went on around our being in Miss Saigon together. And I think that really served us well there because we were just professional. We just did our work, and she was always very generous with me, and we were friends. So it was about the work and doing it well.
Yeah, and she pursued a career, of course, in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
And then you pursued a career in London.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, would you ever want to go back here permanently?
Yes, I would love to. I mean, I miss the Philippines.
Yeah, but can you live on the income here?
No, probably, maybe, hopefully. Yeah, maybe. But I think, I guess what London affords me right now is a chance to keep learning still.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I love the Philippines, and I really love our theater industry here. But I feel that it's our obligation as theater artists to keep learning as much as we can outside so we can keep bringing it back here.
Yeah.
So that means the industry grows as opposed to us just coming back and just acting.
Yes.
No, we have to make a contribution so that, because the theater industry here is in its baby stages by. You know,
it
needs to grow still, you know, as big as the other media industries. So,
yeah.
So I think it's our obligation to keep learning. And England can do that for you because it's such a huge, huge theater industry there.
Pinky Amador told me something very interesting. She said that theater is not part of our history, so it's not instinctive. Although most Filipinos sing and act naturally.
Yeah. The singing, I think, is part of our culture. Yeah. But I think we need to develop our audiences more. Because, for example, like in England, they already go to theater at a very young age.
Correct.
So they're watching Shakespeare when they're 9 or 8 years old. So to them, it's really a part of their everyday existence. So in a way, that's what a lot of us theater people are trying to do here, is trying to make it part of the culture, part of the like habit of a regular person to just go and watch theater. Because
what is your favorite song that you sang?
Where?
Of course, in a play.
In a
and
play?
This is where it happens.
I think...
Oh, it started with Miss Saigon. That's a classic for many Filipinos.
Yeah.
What's your favorite song?
I always like the song Sun and Moon. I just thought it was so sweet and so poetic and so beautiful in a way.
Okay.
And I guess when I was singing it when I was 19, it kind of felt new and magical. You know, now that I'm 41, I kind of think, oh, it's still a beautiful song, but it kind of takes on a different meaning already.
Can you sing parts of it?
Yeah, sure. Okay. You are sunlight and I moon, joined by the gods of fortune, midnight and high noon, sharing the sky. We have been blessed, you and I.
My gosh!
Too early in the morning.
Ano ka ba? Lumalabas nga ng naturally. Yung iba, hirap na hirap eh. Too early. All right. And you also performed, this was challenging, in Andrew Lloyd Webber's Aspects of Love, where you were required to actually age 15 years.
Yes.
So you were playing and you kissed like 10 men on stage.
Yeah, women and men.
Women and men on stage.
You know, because this is what's exciting about theater, is that you have to do everything on that one night, in those 3 hours or 2 hours. You know, there isn't any take two or take three.
Yes.
That's why we have to rehearse for months. You have to rehearse for months because it's really finding the character, it's exploring it, it's deepening it, making it real.
Uh-oh.
And also getting the journey right. You know, because Shemper, when you want people to watch, you know, you want them to really get transported into another world.
Correct.
And it's your job as an actor to really to lead them on that journey. And I think that's what's exciting about live theater.
Yeah.
Because you're right there in the audience witnessing all of that.
Agree.
Yeah.
And you can't rewind.
No, you can't.
I mean, when you're watching a movie, I was just watching it. It's a great scene. You rewind it, and then you see it over and over.
Yeah.
Theater, if you miss it, that's it.
Yeah, they say theater lives for the moment.
Correct.
But it's magical. It's really magical because it's live, it's breathing, it's pulsing.
Yeah, wait, did you sing in Aspects of Love?
Yes, I did.
Okay,
you
can sing one of your... it's a Friday.
Seeing is believing. I saw you and I loved you. Is this really him? Am I dreaming?
My gosh!
Yung medyo soprano.
Oh, may pagka soprano factor. Pero king and I.
King and I, that those are different songs.
Yeah, do you know one in King and I that's popular? I think I can't remember.
Well, I guess getting to know you, getting to know all about you, getting to like you, getting to hope you like me.
Oh my God, grabe mo ni. Iba ka. Ikaw dapat tularan. You don't drink?
No, I don't drink or smoke.
At all?
No.
No, because I heard that either Adele from London,
yeah,
was either drinking at one point or still drinking, or I don't know, but she's also 23.
Yeah. You know what, Karen? You have to be so ultra-disciplined when you do theater. And this is my best advice to young theater artists. Not just theater, even film and TV.
Yeah.
You know, your instrument is your body when you're an actor, and your mind and your heart. So you have to keep everything healthy. Mentally, emotionally, and physically. You have to get enough hours of sleep.
Yeah, I don't.
You don't,
this
I know.
Is terrible.
And you have to be kind and good to your body, because this is what's going to serve you when you're on stage. You cannot abuse it, because how do you get into those parts and roles, and how do you transport
great.
It?
So you don't have wine at all?
No.
At all?
I don't drink or smoke.
No, the smoking, I don't smoke either. But you don't have red wine or white wine or champagne?
No.
Oh, my God. Water.
I'm like a monk.
No. Water all the way.
You know, a lot of people think that it's so glamorous, theater. You know, like being on stage. Actually, it's not. It's really, really hard work. You have to cloister yourself.
So
you have to cloister yourself. Like, for example, if I'm doing a show, I have to sleep 10 hours and I have to go away from smoky, loud areas where, because if you're in a bar, you'll be forced to speak over music.
Correct.
And then next day, baka paos ka na, or you're tired. You cannot be tired if you're going to sing a 3-hour musical.
Correct.
You know, and singing is very physical. You have to be like an Olympian.
In a way.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're a voice athlete.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm so amazed, but do you eat chocolate?
I do. I do. But not right before the show.
Yeah. So what do you do with acid reflux?
Well, that's why you have to drink a lot of water, but that's why you have to train also. This is part of the thing also of training.
Yeah.
You know, when you have a technique, both for acting and singing, then you can really rely on your technique.
Yeah.
Because you can sing through a cold, through a sore throat, through
you
illness.
You can sing through a sore throat?
Yeah, and you should be able to, because then if you have a proper technique, then you don't damage your voice, even if you're suffering from a cold or you're sick. And this is what I was telling you earlier that a lot of Filipinos are super duper talented, and I see this, Karen. I mean, I watch shows abroad, and I keep thinking, gosh, kung Pinoy yan,
mas magaling
talaga, mas mafe-feel mo yung emotions nila, at ang mga boses talaga, super galing. But sometimes, I think what we need here talaga is the consciousness that we have to sustain and hone our skills.
Correct.
To make us even better.
Yeah.
To make us really comparable with talent.
Because the problem with us Filipinos, so I'm saying it as a race generally, is we tend to wing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because a winging it race.
Because in a way we are naturally talented.
Yes.
We can actually get things quite quick. We're a very quick study.
Correct.
We can understand things quite easily, and we are emotionally available. Give us a piece of text.
I love what you said. We are emotionally available.
Yeah, we are emotionally available. We are in touch with our emotions. So you give a piece of text or an eksena or a scene, makukuha na ng Pinoy yan, because they understand the depth and the feeling.
Uh-oh.
But you ask them to do it twice, thrice, four times, or for 6 months in a show, that's the question. Will they be able to sustain doing it fresh?
Correct.
Night after night. After
fresh.
Night. Yeah.
Meaning the same
intensity. The same truth, the same depth. Because, you know, you can run something in London or Broadway for a year. I did Miss Saigon for 3 years, for example.
Yeah.
Yeah, 3 years. So how do you make that fresh every night? You have different audiences every night. So basically, they want to see a fantastic performance each night.
Yeah.
You cannot say, I'm tired now, so I won't be as good as last night.
Yeah.
You can't. You know, your duty and obligation is to be very good.
Now, do you want to do some fun things like Mamma Mia?
Yes, of course.
I think that would be so easy to sing for.
Yeah,
an
but actually, for me, I think King and I will be fun for me already, because there are children in the show. It's a family musical. I don't often get to do, because in my New Voice Company theater group, we do quite a lot of political and feminist theater.
How did you become an activist?
You know, I went to UP.
Yeah, me too.
I went to UP, and I think I've always been an activist when I was young, but I couldn't marry it with my art and theater. I think when you're young, diba, like you always feel like something is not right, or you kind of sense injustices, and you kind of know you feel angry about it, but you don't know how to articulate it.
Exactly.
You don't know what to do about it. And for many, many years when I was younger, I did theater and I did my activism when I was a student in UP. Until, of course, Vagina Monologues, I found a play that could marry both.
Yeah, me, I'm clearly a feminist.
Great. Yeah. Me too. And I'm glad that you're proud to say it, because, you know, I think what dismays me sometimes is quite a lot of people attach something negative to the word feminist.
Correct.
And it shouldn't be. I think feminism is really giving a woman access to her desires. You know, whether it's economic, physical, sexual, emotional, spiritual. Uh-huh. And I think if you believe that, if you believe a woman deserves that, then you are a feminist.
All right.
You can even be a man and a feminist, too.
So how did you discover Vagina Monologues?
You know, in 1999, I saw it in New York. And I'd been already running my theater company for a few years then.
Is there singing there?
No singing. It's a straight play, so it's a non-musical. And I'm telling you, Karen, I never saw a play where I cried and laughed so hard.
Are you serious?
At the same
time. Can I watch this?
Yes.
Really? I'll watch it. Okay, I'll watch it.
And I think that's what, to me, is what is beautiful about theater. It takes you on this roller coaster ride, which Vagina Monologues did to me in 1999.
Yeah.
So and I felt so connected to it.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of really talking about women's stories that are really largely unspoken in those years. You know, about desire, sex, orgasms, and most importantly, kind of a lot of the abuses that are done to women that we very often are, in many of our cultures around the world, we do not give any voice to, because we're ashamed, or there's stigma attached to it, there's so many taboos. So this play really smashes all of that and rips you open, because in many ways you recognize so much of yourself in these like 17 monologues, because that's your life up there, or the life of your mother, or the life of your grandmother, or your friends. But it was so liberating to watch a play that really spoke about women's issues with so much joy and celebration.
Are you in character there? Or are you Monique Wilson?
No, you are in character. Because
okay, who are you?
Well, it's many women's stories.
Yes.
So depending on what story you read, or what story you perform, then
that's the woman is going
reading,
to read.
Yes. She's going to
she's
do gonna
flip
the
if she asks. I'm kidding. Okay.
But no, it's this kind of beautiful show that really, I think any woman, when they pick up a monologue, even if you're not an actress, you will be able to connect to it in a really deep, fundamental way.
Okay, can you
be able to really talk?
Okay,
talk
what's your favorite monologue? Can you do some? I mean, do you have it in memory?
Yeah, well, one of my favorites is a monologue called "My Vagina Was My Village."
Good God!
It's quite a serious monologue, because it's about.
But the title is.
Yeah, "My Vagina Was My Village." It's about a woman from Bosnia who really recounts her story of rape. That she'd been raped during the Bosnian War.
Right.
And it's really beautiful, because it talks about "My Vagina Was My Village." The metaphor is, you know, when you rape a woman, you diminish not only her but her entire community.
Yeah.
And you also humiliate the men who felt they couldn't protect her. So in a way, it's in a time of war, as you know.
Yeah.
Because of all the news, when you rape a woman during a time of war, it's a systematic tactic of war.
It is.
You know. So that metaphor of using, like, the village as a metaphor, like your body is like your village. It's who you are. Because when we say village, what do we know? It's your home. It's your identity. You know, and I think it's so powerful and shocking to hear a monologue where a woman is saying, you know, the soldier shoved rifles inside me.
That's the monologue.
Yeah.
No, because the titles.
And when you hear it, it's so. Because when you read a statistic about rape.
Yeah.
Some people don't feel anything anymore.
Yes, I agree.
Because they think it's a statistic, it's a report.
And if you don't know the story behind the title, the title almost seems funny, you know, until you tell us exactly what it's about.
Yeah. Can you imagine, like, shoving sticks and bottles up your vagina? And it's like, and you know, we did this in 2002 in the Philippine Senate and Congress.
Yeah.
We did vagina monologues there.
I should have done vagina monologues.
Yeah, next year you're going to join us,
next year
I'll
join you.
And a lot of the people who we performed for at the Senate and Congress were telling us, You know, this is such a different experience because we normally just read reports about violence against women. We never hear actually an art form or a theatrical
Correct.
Form where we're actually hearing the heart and soul of that woman who experienced it. And they were much more moved. And they were so moved that it really helped pass the laws on domestic violence and sex trafficking. Because I think theater is so powerful. This is what I tell my fellow artists, you know. We have a huge responsibility because it's a huge platform to be able to incite, inspire people, educate them, provoke them into action. Because when you're feeling something live, you are feeling it at that moment.
Yeah.
And if you are outraged about something or if you're excited about something, it really will propel you to act on it. And that's, I think, the beauty of Vagina Monologues.
All right.
And V-Day.
Okay, we'll take a quick break. When we return, our guest, Monique Wilson, will answer questions from you, our viewers, from Facebook and Twitter. Hot Copy, we'll be right back.